the book of Genesis, the third chapter, verses 1-6. Genesis chapter 3, beginning with verse 1 and reading down through verse 6. Now the serpent was more subtle than any beast of the field which the Lord God had made. And he said unto the woman, Yea, hath God said, Ye shall not eat of every tree of the garden? And the woman said unto the serpent, We may eat of the fruit of the trees of the garden, but of the fruit of the tree which is in the midst of the garden, God hath said, Ye shall not eat of it, neither shall ye touch it, lest ye die. And the serpent said unto the woman, Ye shall not surely die. For God doth know that in the day ye eat thereof, then your eyes shall be opened, and ye shall be as gods, knowing good and evil. And when the woman saw that the tree was good for food, and that it was pleasant to the eyes, and a tree to be desired to make one wise, she took of the fruit thereof, and did eat, and gave also unto her husband with her, and he did eat. Amen. I want to talk about the mistake of doubting God. The mistake of doubting God. Amen. Thank you, Rashid. The mistake of doubting God. When you look in Genesis chapter 1 and 2, we have a record of what God has already done. We know Genesis 1 and 2 testifies that it was the Lord who created the heavens and the earth and everything that exists therein. And God himself declared that what he had done was very good. God, the Bible tells us, planted a garden eastward and called it Eden. And scripture tells us that in chapter 2, there he formed man from the dust of the earth, breathed into his nostrils the breath of life, and man became a living soul. Scripture says when God made man, he put him in that garden to keep it and to dress it. That place became man's home. What he had, as we see in scripture, when God put the man in the garden, there was no such thing as crime. There was no poverty. There was no drugs or drug pushers. There was no sickness. There was no death. There were no broken homes. There were no abusive relationships. There was no robbing and killing. There was no children being molested. But when we look in our day and time, we see all of these things and more taking place. And the question comes, what happened? Since God had made everything fine then, over and against now? Well, the answer is sin happened. Sin entered on the scene. When you look in this third chapter of the book of Genesis, you'll see in the first three chapters of this first book of the Bible that the devil is seen for the first time. And then when you go to the last book of the Bible, the book of Revelation, you'll see in the last three chapters of the book of Revelation that the devil is seen for the last time. In the first three chapters of the first book, he's seen for the first time. In the last three chapters of the last book, he's seen for the last time. All the other chapters in between, the devil is busy. Now, brothers and sisters, as we look here in this third chapter of the book of Genesis, we see God had made man and he has made a woman. And he blessed them with the best home ever on earth. when he put them in the Garden of Eden. I've said before, and I repeat it again, if anybody ever had it made, Adam and Eve had it made. I mean, they didn't have no house note. They had no water bill. They did not have to worry about thieves and robbers. They had plenty of water because the Bible said they had four rivers that flowed through the garden. Scripture tells us that they were not broke because there was gold in the garden. They had everything. They didn't have to worry about storms because storms were not happening at that time. If anybody ever had it made, Adam and Eve had it made, there was plenty to eat because God said, of all the trees in the garden, thou mayest freely eat. Am I right about it? Adam and Eve had paradise on earth. They had it made. Adam didn't have to worry about some other man looking at his wife. Eve didn't have to worry about some other woman looking at her man. Because technically they had it made. Everything was right. Everything was going for Adam and Eve. They had the happiest home ever. You can't ask for anything any better than what God had blessed Adam and Eve to have. There were no headaches. There was no body aches. Everything was just right. But in chapter 3, the devil showed up. He came in the form of a serpent. And isn't it something, every time God bestow a blessing, you can look for a testing. Every time God bless you with something, get ready, the devil will show up. Are y'all praying with me? The devil appears in the form of a serpent. And because he showed up, we have recorded in this third chapter of the book of Genesis, the first instance of anybody doubting God. The record says that he approached the woman and said to her, "Hey, did God say you shall not eat of every tree of the garden?" And she answered by saying, "We may eat of the fruit of the trees of the garden, but the fruit of the tree which is in the midst of the garden, God said that we should not eat from it or touch it, lest we die." And he responded by saying, "Oh, you ain't gonna die. God doth know that the day you eat thereof, your eyes will be open, and you will be like gods, knowing good and evil." And consequently, Eve listened to the snake. It never fails. Every time somebody listens to snake talk, they end up going contrary to God's will. Are y'all listening to me? My brothers and sisters, here he convinced her to doubt God. Yes, Eve is guilty of doubting God. And listen, the devil wants everybody who is a believer to doubt God. It is his goal to get you and I to doubt God. Now, let me say this to you this morning for the sake of clarity. There is a difference between unbelief and doubting God. There's a difference between unbelief and doubt. Unbelief says that you refuse to believe. Doubt says you question what you already believe. Are y'all listening to me? That's what doubt is. It means that you already believe in something, but you begin to have second thoughts. You start second guessing. Yes, that's what doubt is all about. Now, my brothers and my sisters, doubting, this text teaches us, can cause serious consequences. Right. Doubting God, my brothers and sisters, can hinder us from receiving blessings from God. Yes. But this text teaches us also that doubting God can eventually cause us to lose what God has already given us. Yes, this text teaches us something about doubting God. So remember, there is a difference between unbelief and doubt. To doubt means that you believe in something, but you have begun to start having questions about what you believe. Let me try to show you if I can. When you read in the Gospel of Matthew, the 14th chapter, you will read about Jesus came walking on the water in the midst of a storm to his disciples. Now, when you read there, you will see that when Jesus identified himself, made known to his disciples that it was him, it was Peter, you remember, that said, "Lord, if it's you, give me permission to come to you on the water." Jesus said, "Come on." Peter stepped out of the boat and started walking on the water on his way to Jesus. But Peter got distracted and he took his eyes off the Lord and he started sinking. And when he started sinking, he said, "Lord, save me." And scripture says in that 14th chapter that Jesus called him. And when the Lord called him, he said these words, "O ye of a little faith, why did you doubt?" Did you catch that? He said when he was sinking and called him, "O ye of a little faith," which means he had some faith. And the reason why he started sinking is because he began to doubt. I wish y'all were praying. Yes, he began to doubt what he had already believed. Well, he's not the only one. When you read in Matthew chapter 11, you read about when John the Baptist was locked up in prison. When he heard about the works of Jesus Christ, he sent two of his disciples to Jesus with a question. And the question was, "Are you the one that should come? Or are we to look for somebody else?" Now mind you now, this is the same John the Baptist who had identified Jesus at the Jordan River. He said, "Behold the Lamb of God who takes away the sins of the world." But when he was locked up in prison, he started having doubts and he sent word saying, "Are you the one?" Jesus told those disciples, "Go back and tell John what you hear and see. Tell him that the lepers are cleansed, the dead are raised, the blind receive their sight." John started having doubts, but Jesus sent word back to him saying, "I'm the one. No, you don't need to look for nobody else because I am the one." Yes, God had to reassure him because he was having some doubts. And so as I look at this text, my brothers and sisters, I see how the devil put doubt in the minds of Eve and Adam. Well, the question now comes, what was it that he wanted them to doubt? What was it that the devil wanted them to doubt that he wants you and I to doubt today? Well, first of all, he wanted them to doubt the word of God. Listen to what the verse said. He said that, "Yea, had God said, ye shall not eat of every tree of the garden?" Okay. Now, listen to what he said. He said, "Did God say that?" He said, "Did God tell you? Did God say that?" Now, the reason why you got to catch that is because when you read back in Genesis 2, the Bible says after the Lord had created and made everything, The verse says in chapter 2, verse 7, that the Lord God formed the man from the dust of the earth and breathed into his nostrils the breath of life, and man became a living soul. Verse 8 of Genesis 2 said the Lord God planted a garden eastward in Eden, and there he put the man whom he had formed. Are y'all listening to me? Well, when you read on, you get down there around that 17th and 18th verse, God said to the man, say, of all the trees in the garden, thou mayest freely eat. But of the tree of the knowledge of good and evil, he said, thou shalt not eat of it, for in the day thou eatest thereof, thou shalt surely die. Verse 18 of Genesis 2 said, and the Lord God said, it's not good for man to be alone. Now here's what I'm trying to tell you. When God gave the commandment, he gave it to the man. It was before the woman was made. So technically, when God said it, the woman wasn't there. Are y'all following me? It was after God had commanded the man that God said, man is not good for him to be alone. God put him to sleep, took one of his ribs and made for him a helpmeet. And when Adam woke up and saw what God had given him, he said, bone of my bone, flesh of my flesh. Since I'm a man, you shall be called woman, because you were taken from the man. So in chapter 3, since Eve didn't hear God say that, he said, did God say it? I mean, it's almost like he was saying, did you hear him say? Were you there when he said, how you know he said? The devil wants to put doubt in their mind. Are you sure? For real? Did God really? You sure that ain't something your husband made up? I wish y'all were praying with me. He wants you to doubt God's word. And let me tell you something. We should never doubt God's word. Are y'all listening to me? He'll try to make you think it's a waste of time to read the Bible. He'll try to tell you the Bible is just another ordinary book. But that's not so. The Bible is a book of books. It's a library of books. The Bible is the inspired word of God. The Bible is the greatest book in the world. There is no book in the world like the Bible, because the Bible is the living word of God. That's why Hebrews 4 and 12 said the word of God is alive. That's the reason why when you come to church on Sunday morning, preacher don't know nothing about you and what you've been through. But when you get up to preach, he'll preach something that step all on your toes. Get all in your business. You wonder, well, how did he know? Because the word is alive. The Lord knows what you need to hear. Are y'all praying with me? Bible said, man shall not live by bread alone, but by every word that proceeds from the mouth of God. Don't doubt God's word. His word is real. His word is alive. His word is life-giving. His word is life-sustaining. His word will feed your hungry soul. Don't doubt God's word. 2 Peter chapter 1 tells us that the scripture came not by some private interpretation, but holy men of God spake and wrote as they were moved by the Holy Ghost. Yes, it was God's doing. Yes, that's why. Look at this. I mean, let me show you something in this chapter. Notice now when God spoke this command, if you'll look there in the verse, in verse 16 of Genesis 2, he said, of all the trees of the garden, of every tree, this is the word he said, of every tree of the garden thou mayest freely eat. The two words I want to point out God said was every and freely. He said, of every tree thou mayest freely eat. All right. When Eve talked about it, Notice she left out these two words. She said nothing about every and freely. So she left out some stuff that God said. That's not all. See, she dropped those two words. But then God also said in verse 17, you will surely die. Well, when Eve mentioned the dying part in the latter portion of verse 3, she said, lest. Well, God didn't say lest. He said, surely. Are y'all listening to me? And plus, Eve added something that God didn't say. She added what she said, neither shall ye touch it. You got to be careful about adding to and taking from what God said. Just take him at his word. So he wants you to doubt the word of God. That's the reason why it means everything for you to know your Bible. Study your Bible. Be taught from the Bible. This will help you because there are those who will ease up to you and tell you the Lord told me to tell you. Are y'all listening to me? Everything you need to know is in the book. Amen. From Genesis to Revelation. You got to watch out for who pull your side and say, God, I'm going to prophesy to you. We already got it. Right here in the book. Lord, the Lord told me to tell you, since you go to church and your spouse don't go to church, that you need to leave them. That's a lie. God ain't said that. When you read 1 Corinthians 7, God says something different. Are y'all praying with me? God told me to tell you, you're going to get a two-story house and $1 million. And then they're going to say, and when you get the $1 million, remember me. Nothing but a lie. Are you listening to me? You don't need nobody pulling you aside telling you, God gave me a word from you. Why you got to get it secondhand? He's already wrote you a letter. All you got to do is read it and believe what he's already said. So first of all, he wants us to doubt the word of God. But then secondly, he wants us to doubt the truthfulness of God. Listen to what he said. When she said that we should not eat of it, neither shall we touch it, lest we die. Okay. Verse 4, he said, you're not gonna die. He's trying to make it look like God was lying. Okay. Are y'all with me? God said you will die. The devil said you ain't gonna die. Somebody lying. And it sure ain't God. Oh, y'all listen to me. It's not God at all. Numbers 23 and 19 says, God is not a man that he should lie. Am I right about it? What God spoke is the truth. And you can look for it to happen. Everything God says is nothing but truth. It's the whole truth. Nothing but the truth. Everything that God said, when he said in Galatians 6 and 7, be not deceived. God is not mocked. Whatsoever man sowed, that shall he reap. That's the truth. Are y'all listening to me? That's the truth. In Revelation 20, when he said, I saw the dead, both small and great, stand before God, and the books were opened. And he said, death and hell were cast into the lake of fire. And those whose names were not found written in the book of life were cast into the lake of fire. Baby, that's the truth. That's going to happen. Everything that God said is the truth. Romans 6:23 says, for the wages of sin is death, but the gift of God is eternal life. That's the truth. Jesus said in John 14:6, I am the way, the truth, and the life. Everything God said is true. Romans 10, that if thou shalt confess with thy mouth the Lord Jesus and believe in your heart that God has raised him from the dead, thou
shall be saved. That's the truth. He didn't say you got to speak in tongues to be saved. Are y'all listening to me? He didn't say you got to be a part of a certain denomination to be saved. He said believe on the Lord Jesus Christ. That's the truth. So we want them to doubt. Truth God said, he's not going to die. You know, that's a lie from the devil. Then there's a third thing he wants us to doubt. He wants us to doubt the goodness of God. I'm almost through. He wants us to doubt the goodness of God. Listen to what he said. He said, you're not going to die. Verse 5. For God doth know that in the day you eat thereof, your eyes shall be opened. Now, he makes it sound like he's trying to make them think that God is really holding something good back from you. He said, God knows that your eyes are going to be open and you're going to be like God's. He's trying to make them think God is not really that good to you. Are y'all listening to me? He's trying to get them to doubt the goodness of God. And listen, God had been good to them. Now, you remember I tried to tell you how things were in the garden, but let me mention this to you. God was so good to them that he gave them all of this without them having to ask for it. What God gave them, they didn't even ask for. Are y'all listening to me? That's just how good he is. He'll give you blessings that you didn't even ask for. Are y'all listening to me? The devil wants you to doubt the goodness of God. Psalm 100 said, the Lord is good. His mercy is everlasting and his truth endureth to all generations. Don't miss out on recognizing the goodness of God by looking at what other folk have that you don't have. Just because you don't have everything other folk got does not mean that God has not been good to you. Just because your house is not as big as somebody else does not mean that he's not good to you. God is good to you. As a matter of fact, he's been better to you than anybody else could be. So all I need to tell you is everything you see folk got is not necessarily a blessing. Some for what they got, they stole it. Some took advantage of somebody to get it. Some lied to get it. Are y'all listening to me? Some are selling drugs to get it. Are y'all praying for me? Yeah, everybody got what they got don't mean they got it the right way. You got to be careful. That's why the psalmist said, I was envious when I saw the prosperity of the wicked. In Psalm 73, he said, you know, I just couldn't understand how folk who didn't go to church, who didn't serve God, looked like everything they touched turned to gold. And here I was trying to serve the Lord, yet I was struggling. God spoke to him and said, wait a minute. Why should you be envious of somebody that's headed to hell? You don't be jealous of somebody that's hell bound. Being blessed in life is not measured by things. Are y'all praying with me? So then don't miss out on God's goodness in your life because you're looking at what somebody else has. As I close here, I stop by to tell you, rather than being upset about what you don't have, you ought to be busy praising God for what he's already given you. I'm too busy counting my blessings. I ain't got time to be worried about what somebody else got. Because I'm so thankful for what the Lord has already given me. And oh, my brothers and my sisters, when you realize how good he is to you, you don't have time for jealousy and envy. You don't have time to be envious of anybody because the Lord is mighty good to you. Somebody here can testify with me. He's been so good to me. He's been better than what I deserve. When I look at how good he's been to me, I know I don't deserve it. But I'm so glad he blessed me anyhow. And I wonder if anybody here can testify with me this morning. Everything God has done for me, it's not because I did all the right things. It's not because I've been good. Because the truth is I've been messed up from the floor. But God is still blessing me. I wonder, do I have a witness? God blessed me in spite of me. God blessed me with more than folk wanted me to have. because he's just that good. Ain't God all right? Anybody here know it was the goodness of the Lord that woke you up this morning? It was the goodness of God that has spared your life. It was the goodness of God that has kept you day by day. It's because of the goodness of God that you're still in your right mind. Have I got a witness? It was the goodness of God that kept folk from robbing you. It's the goodness of God that didn't let you fall in some traps that some enemies had set for you. I thank God for your goodness. Have I got a witness? Well, finally, let me tell you, there's one more thing. The old devil wants you to doubt about God. He wants you to doubt the wisdom of God. Listen to what he said. Your eyes will be opened and you'll be like God. Well, that's a lie, because can't nobody be like God. He's in a class all by himself. The reason why the devil, who was once an angel, got kicked out of heaven is because he tried to be like God. Anybody here know when you try to be like God, you're on your way out? Have I got a witness? He said you'll be like God, knowing good and evil. Let me close by telling you, there's a whole lot of things God don't want me to know. Have I got a witness? And I'm not going to bother him about it. Long as he knows, that's good enough for me. Have I got a witness? Anybody here know that your life is in his hand? That's good enough for me. Anybody here know he's a way out of no way? That's good enough for me. Just to know he's a burden bearer, that's good enough for me. Just to know that all things work together for good for those who love him and who are called according to his purpose, that's good enough for me. Just to know he came into this world, went to a hill called Calvary. He died for our sins, buried in a borrowed tomb, but early Sunday morning he rose. Somebody said, well, preacher, how do you know that he rose? How you know he died? Did you see him? No. Did you see him when he rose? No. Well, tell me, how can you say he died and rose? I believe what God said. Have I got a witness? Anybody here know that faith has absolutely nothing to do with what you see? You just gotta believe. Ain't God all right? Because